morning and welcome to worship.
Do we have any announcements? I'm not seeing any raised hands. All righty. Beautiful day today, so let's join together in the call to worship. If you can stand as you are able. Come walk in the way that leads to life. It's better to be reconciled with another than to be proven right. Come choose to live a genuine life. Life is too short for petty resentments. Come walk in the way Christ invites us to travel. We give thanks for Christ's way and for the freedom to follow. We'll remain standing and sing hymn number 467 in the Red Book, Trust and Obey.
Alex. Let us join together in a modern affirmation of faith. As we proclaim our faith, it is found in United Methodist hymnal number 885. It is also printed in your bulletin. But let us join in this affirmation. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as a divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in our example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
That sounded great, ladies and Justin. Thank you. Our scripture lesson for today is Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 15 through 20. Look here, today I've set before you life and what's good versus death and what's wrong. If you obey the Lord your God's commandments that I'm commanding you right now by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments, his regulations, and his case laws, then you will live and thrive, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you refuse to listen and are so misled, worshiping other gods and serving them, I'm telling you right now that you will definitely die. You will not prolong your life on the fertile land that you are crossing the Jordan River to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth as my witnesses against you right now. I have set life and death, blessing and curse before you. Now choose life so that you and your descendants will live by loving the Lord your God, by obeying his voice, and by clinging to him. That's how you will survive and live long on the fertile land the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everybody. It's nice to be with you again. So, do we all remember a time or a place or a situation where you tried to build a new habit? Where you said to yourself, you know what, I'm going to start exercising. Or I'm going to start eating right. Or I'm going to read the Upper Room or my Bible every day or pray for 30 minutes. Anybody remember a time like that? Or some effort you made for that, repeatedly maybe, right? So, my favorite is eating right, okay, just because I like to eat, and all of you know I like White Castle, so there's a lot of work there. But I think it's really funny, when we talk about these kind of things, when we talk about establishing a new habit, it always goes the same way, right? Okay, so I'm going to eat well, okay? So first off, whenever we're going to do this, right, it always starts on a Monday. Right? It always starts on a Monday, right? So we got to take that weekend to like gird up, right? Or eat horribly, kind of like a Fat Tuesday thing, right? Eat horribly Saturday and Sunday. It's like, okay, on Monday, I'm going to start eating well, right? And so Monday, you're all ready. You're all enthusiastic. Right? And so you have a bowl of plain oatmeal for breakfast. Right? No bacon, no eggs, nothing fried, just plain oatmeal. And lunch, you have one of those scary lettuce leaves with the tuna, the scoop of tuna salad on it, right? And then dinner, you have like fish and steamed vegetables and plain potato or something like that. And you go to bed and you're like, I did it, right? I ate healthy today, right? And then you wake up Tuesday. And Tuesday, you're doing it, and maybe you make it through breakfast, but then, you know, there's a package of cookies in the pantry, right? And so you have a cookie with your tuna salad or whatever, right? And then dinner, there's a piece of leftover cake floating around or something like that, and you have cake. And you know how this rest of this story plays out, right? Wednesday, it's a little bit worse. Thursday, you're right. By Saturday, you're back at White Castle, right? Saturday, you're at White Castle if you haven't gotten a Big Mac and McDonald's or something, right? And if you've made it a week on eating well, that's pretty good. Most people, I think, fade away within the first couple of days. Exercise is the same way, right? Monday morning, you get up, you work out, and then workout's worse. By Saturday, you're done, right? You're not gonna see those gym shoes again until the next doctor visit. And the doctor goes through and says, your cholesterol's high, your blood pressure's high, blah, 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 and then you do this again. Why is it so hard for us to do this? You ever think about that? Why is it so hard for us to establish a new pattern like that or a new habit? So one possibility is it's a knowledge question, right? But eating well is not a knowledge question, right? Unless you've been living under a rock for the past 30 years, you know how to eat well, right? You know that you should cut out all your saturated and trans fats, that you shouldn't eat a lot of red meat, that you should eat more fruits and vegetables, not cream corn with butter, but steam corn. And right, you know how to do this stuff, right? Eat more nuts, all that stuff. So the problem isn't up here, right? I mean, we've been actually, as a society, we've been inundated with the correct knowledge of how to eat correctly. So that's not the problem. Is the problem that it's hard to do? Is it really that much more difficult to eat steam corn than buttered corn? Is it really that much more difficult to eat a piece of fish than a Big Mac? Is it really difficult? When we're, I mean, you know, physically difficult. Is it really that hard to eat well? And again, I don't think that that's what happens, right? It's pretty easy to just make healthy choices on your food, but we still don't do it, right? So what makes this so hard? What makes this so hard? And I think the thing that we have to recognize is that at the same time we're talking about establishing this new habit, I am going to eat healthy now. And it's not that hard to establish that new habit, that there's an old habit. Eating poorly is just as much a habit, right, as eating healthy. But for the past 60 years, I have eaten unhealthy. And so to take that, maybe starting a new pattern, a new rhythm there is easy, but letting go of this old pattern is pretty hard. That's where I think it gets difficult, is letting go of our old patterns. So this morning, we are back in the Old Testament. We're in Deuteronomy, and we're getting a glimpse of what God is saying through Moses to the Hebrews, right? The Hebrews that just came out of Egypt. And so remember where they're coming from. Remember their mental state here, okay? They're coming out of slavery, out of bondage. They're nobody. They're not a people. They're not a nation. They have no identity. They're nothing. They're slaves. And Moses leads them out. And Moses is tasked not only with helping them understand their God, their selectiveness, that God's chosen them, but Moses and God have this task of forming them into a people, of giving them an identity, of helping them understand that they are holy before God. But this old habit, this old idea, this old identity still is there. I'm nothing. I'm a slave in Egypt. I have no identity. And so they have to overcome this and turn them into the nation of Israel, God's chosen people who are going to take possession of the land promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Right? I got to start that all over. And so in the scripture, it says, I put before you, God is giving them a choice. I put before you life and death. Choose life. Choose to love God. Choose to follow his commandments. Choose to follow his laws. Choose to do this, and you will inherit the land and live long and prosper. And so if it were just a knowledge thing, if it were just a doing thing, how easy would this be? Right? How easy would this be? And yet the Old Testament, the rest of the Old Testament, is full of history of how this people wanders away from God. Wanders away from God. Every time you turn the page, they're messing up somehow. Why is it so hard for us to do this? And I think the question is, and you probably know the answer to this, is that what we think, the knowledge that we have, and what we do with our hands isn't by itself who we are. Who we are is a question of spirit. Who we are is a question of what is in our heart. This always answers the question of, you know, do good people do bad things? Do bad people do good things? Is that what's in your heart, what's in our spirit, gets revealed in what we do and what we say and what we think. So if your spirit is disconnected from God, then you are going to lean back into who we are as a base humanity, right? As back to Adam and Eve, that I want my own control. I want to control my own life. I don't want to listen to somebody else. I want to make sure that my life is run in a way that takes care of me and my family and my loved ones. I don't want to be accountable to a God that's going to call me to a higher calling. I want to live my life the way I want to live. Right? That's the great conflict in the Bible, isn't it? The great conflict in the Bible is that humans want to do it their way. They want to run the world their way. They want to make sure that they are taken care of. And God comes through Jesus and says, there's more to being you than just that. There's a God, there's a divine, there's a creator that loves you, that cares about you, that knows you. There's a God that seeks your eternal life, that you would be forever with this God. And yet we still don't do it. It's so easy, right? It is so easy on words and in conception to say, yes, we're going to dedicate our lives to God. We're going to open up our spirits. We're going to change ourselves. It is so easy to say that. And yet we've still got this old pattern. We've got this pattern that Adam displayed in the story. We want to be in control. We disconnect ourselves from God. And so this topic, I think, ends up talking about something interesting that we don't talk a lot about in church, and that is, what role does the Holy Spirit have to do with our lives? How do we connect to that, right? And the Holy Spirit, right, is every Sunday school teacher's nightmare. Because when the kid asks you, well, what's the Holy Spirit? All of us kind of bumble around with an answer because we're not really, really sure, right? The Holy Spirit, you know, God the Father, well described, well attested to in the Bible. Jesus Christ, well described in the Bible. But then you get to the Holy Spirit and you see some of the stuff the Holy Spirit's doing, but you're not sure exactly how to describe it. One of the weirdest questions I ever got in seminary was my counseling professor, my pastoral counseling professor, who was from a different country, asked the class, do you believe in evil spirits? Do you believe in evil spirits? I came up through the American education system. We learned the scientific method. We learned facts. I can regurgitate facts on tests, all those things. But to be asked, do I believe in evil spirits, is actually such a simple question and yet so confrontational. Do you believe in evil spirits? Because we're told that God's Spirit resides within us. We're told that God's Spirit is the thing that sustains us, that teaches us, that reminds us of Jesus. The Holy Spirit is the thing that allows us to do good works. And yet, how often do we have a conversation about that? How often do we talk about what the Holy Spirit is doing within us at any given point? How often do we come to people that we love and say, how is it with your spirit? How have you seen God today? How have you seen the church at work? But we have these secular, very generic conversations. We talk about the budget, talk about the building. We gossip about the personalities. how often do we get to the business of the church, of making disciples for Jesus Christ, of growing ourselves? How often do we avail ourselves to the Holy Spirit? All of us have good intentions, right? All of us, if we could do it, would pray 30 minutes a day, read our Bibles every day, be with God, and look for that transformation, look for that change that comes, that is very undescribable and happens over a period of time when we immerse ourselves with the Spirit. But how often do we do it? How often can we build that new habit? That's, I think, an incredibly hard thing, an incredibly challenging thing for us, because while at one point we will say that this is good, we should do this as a church, this is how we grow. This is how we grow in our holiness. This is how we grow in how we are separated for God's purposes on the world. This is it. This is how we do it. We immerse ourselves and partner with the Holy Spirit. And yet, how often do we do it? How often do we do it? And so that's really the challenge. The challenge is not to change what we do, okay? It's not a question, and the church, and I get it, the church has a long history of this, right? If you just give the right amount of money, right? If you come to confessional, if you come to mass enough times, if you, right, all those things. If you do the right things, you'll be good, right? You will be good. If you say the right things, we said the affirmation of faith. If you say the right things, you're good. Right? Some church traditions have it. If I baptize you, you're done. You're cooked. You're good. You're saved. And yet, for Wesleyan tradition, that's the beginning of the journey. That's the beginning of the journey where you have said yes to God. You have chosen life. You've said yes. And you have said, now, I want to open up myself to the Spirit and become better than just what my nature has. I want to be transformed by the Holy Spirit into somebody that God is pleased with. I'm not going to fake it. I'm not going to do the motions. I'm going to change in here, and that comes out in my actions. How often do we think about the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives? Where is your heart? At the end of the day, that's the question. Where is your treasure? Where is your heart? Are you tied up so tightly in the affairs of the church? Are you tied up so tightly in the affairs of local politics or national politics? Are you so tied into what's going on with your family or friends that you forget what the big question is, the big goal of being one of God's children, of being transformed by that, of hearing the words, "Well done, faithful servant," at the end of this journey? How often do we remember that? How often do we strive for it? How often do we ask God to lead us to those places? We have to answer that. We have to answer that. That is a challenge that stands before every disciple of Jesus Christ. Where does my faith lie? Where is it on my priority list? Where is it on my to-do list? Where is it in terms of my life? Where do I hold God in all of this? Where is my heart? So that's my challenge for you today. Where is your heart? Where is your spirit? And how does God's Spirit work with yours to grow you? Grow you in your holiness, grow you in your love of God, grow you in your love of neighbor. Where is that for you in your lives? I pray that the Holy Spirit will be with you, will help you think through that, will help guide you into those places and those practices and those things that grow you over time, that turn you into the kind of person that God always envisioned for you. May God make it so, and may the Holy Spirit be with us. Amen. Our next hymn this morning is Only Trust Him. It is in your United Methodist hymnal number 337. We always have an opportunity to come together to recognize the way God has been present in our lives of our loved ones and our families, and to recognize and lift up prayers of need, the way that we continue to need God's grace and mercy in our lives. So at this time, I would invite you, does anybody have any prayers of thanksgiving or joy or God sightings they would like to share before God and the congregation?
Well, I have two things. yesterday, I went to visit a good friend of mine, Carolyn. She's been struggling with leukemia for a year and a half, and she did, last fall, went through stem cell transplant. So just recently, she's been able to accept visitors, and if you're healthy and can wear a mask, you can meet with her. So I haven't seen her since July, so we got together and spent a nice time together. Unfortunately, she told me that her spinal fluid has shown cancer cells and also in her brain. So she has to go twice a week for a new chemotherapy treatment into the spinal fluid. Mm. And my other joy is last weekend we spent with my my daughter Amy and her two children, her family and my husband. We drove to Pennsylvania and we were able to ski with him. And here's this little five-year-old who just took to it. It was amazing. He just like zipping down the hill. There was no fear, and he was learning to snowplow and stop. And It was just like, whoa, he just learned and just caught on that fast.
Cool.
So
Caroline was the first?
Caroline.
Yes. Okay, so we want to be in thanksgiving to God for getting Caroline this far with the stem cell treatment, but we do want to keep her in our prayers now that she has cancer in the spine and the brain. Keep her in our prayers for God's healing for that. And we're thankful for your family outing and skiing. Yeah, when you're, you know what, when you're this close to the ground, it doesn't matter if you fall, right? You can go as fast as you want. But we give thanks that you had a good family outing and you had snow.
It was cold.
Yeah.
Enough snow to.
Yeah, that's what's important. Yeah. Other joys today. Yeah. Amy?
I'm thankful that my dad has been able to spend the last 6 weeks with us, and I pray for traveling mercies as he heads back to Wisconsin to my sisters. He'll be back here in March, mid-March, so thankful that you've been here for 6 weeks.
Yeah, it's been a joy to have you worshiping with us and seeing you.
I guess I'm thankful that he wants to come back, so.
There you go. He has a choice, right?
Yes.
Yes, but it has been a joy to have you here. It always is, having you worship with us. We pray for safe travel up and for the time you'll spend at your other daughter's, and we look forward to seeing you in mid-March, the middle of Lent. Other joys today.
Well, I have a concern. A good friend was taken to the hospital with COVID yesterday. And we just hope everything goes right.
Okay.
So prayers for her.
What's her name?
Pat Solly.
Who?
Pat Solly.
Pat. Okay. So we want to lift up in prayers Pat, who is in the hospital with COVID. So we pray for God's healing for her and for the wisdom and knowledge for her caregivers. That she get better. Things turn out the right way. Other joys or concerns?
My youngest granddaughter, who's a teacher in Florida, was elected Teacher of the Year this year in her district. So we think that's pretty special.
Wow. Oh, we give God thanks for that, for her skills and her gifts. She's Teacher of the Year for the whole country or for Florida? Just Florida or a whole country?
No, just for the district.
Oh, okay. All right.
But they have big districts.
Do they? Yeah. Okay.
So.
Cool.
I just want to say thank you for the wonderful week I had with my son who was visiting from Seattle, and we were able to get together with my other son. It's a long time since I've just had my two children by myself.
Yeah, cool. We give thanks for that visit and for them traveling home safe, I assume. I think I just know from, yes, having your children come by and visit is a blessing.
I have a joy this morning. My granddaughter, who just turned 26, was able to purchase her very own home.
Woo!
Yes, and I'm so proud of her.
Wow, we give thanks to God for that blessing and that she was able to afford it, and blessings on her new home. That's awesome. Other joys or concerns today?
Yeah, from online, prayers to the family of Debbie Engel, who passed this week.
Okay, so prayers for Debbie Engel. Who passed away, is that a CCC congregant? Okay. So we want to lift up Debbie and Debbie's family in our prayers for God's comfort and for God's comfort as they deal with this season. Anything else? Other joys or concerns today?
Thankful for the sunshine.
Yes. This week we've seen more sunshine than we've seen all winter.
Yes.
It's been, and you really don't realize it until it comes, and then you're like, wow, I haven't seen this in a long time. Yep. Others? Okay, if you'd please join me in an attitude of prayer. Loving God, you came to us in the person of your Son, Jesus Christ, to teach us, to minister to us, to redeem us through his sacrifice on the cross, And yet when we took him and ascended him to heaven, you did not leave us alone, but you gave us the advocate, your Holy Spirit, who continues to sustain us and teach us and reveal things to us about you, about how we are to be, about how we are to be your church. And through that Holy Spirit, we can grow to become more and more the people you envisioned, to become more and more like Christ. We give you thanks for this great gift, and we pray that you would open up our hearts and our minds to the work of your Spirit, that we might be in partnership, that we might come alongside and be sensitive to the things that you call us to be, to do the things you call us to do, to be the people you call us to be. God, we pray in this moment, we know that sometimes we don't always get it right, but we know that you forgive us and that you give us new chances every day. And so help us to commit to being your people here and making glimpses of your kingdom real for those that we encounter. In this week, we give you thanks for all the ways we have seen your goodness in your creation, in our lives, the lives of our families and friends, the ways you've answered prayer, the ways you've healed people, the ways you've given people hope. And at the same time, God, we know so many that mourn the loss of loved ones, who are dealing with illness, who have struggles, mental, physical, spiritual, who live in war zones, who struggle to make ends meet. God, we know there is no shortage of ways that the brokenness of this world appears in people's lives. And so for all those that we've lifted up in name here, and all those that are close to our heart, we pray that they would know that you are with them, that we are with them in the spirit of your love and your mercy. And that we would pray that you would give them your guidance, your wisdom, your patience, your comfort. God, in all these things, we pray in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're also invited to support the church and the kingdom of God through our time, through our talents, through our gifts, through our witness, through all those things, including that which God has made us stewards over. And so if you have an offering this morning, we still do not pass the plate. You are invited to drop that offering off in the plates as you leave. If you are online, you are welcome to send your offerings to your respective church office. But let us join together in prayer over all that we offer God this morning. These offerings belong to you, O Lord, for you are the source of every blessing and joy. Employ these gifts to build your realm. Send them into the world to heal the sick, feed the hungry, and reconcile us to one another. By our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, make your church a true instrument of peace. Amen. And now let us join together and pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our as we forgive those. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us rise and sing our final hymn. Now thank we all our God. It is in your United Methodist hymnal, number 102. As we go from this place to be God's people in the world, receive this blessing. Bear witness to the way of Christ. Go with the compassion of God, the joy of Christ, and the wisdom of the Spirit. Go with God, and Christ will lead you in the way that leads to life. Amen.